Yeah, so we'll just start in a minute or two.
Do you, how many folks are we expecting?
So we are expecting around 8 of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, thanks for organizing this, Simran.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking out your time and being a part of this session.
No problem. Happy to help.
Yes, sir.
While they join, what is and they all the 8 are college students, right?
Yes, sir. All the participants are college students, like from different fields. Some is pursuing their career in commerce, or some in science, like that.
Okay. Is my audio clear?
Yes, sir, your audio is clear.
Okay, perfect.
Okay, so sir, shall we start?
Yes, let's go.
Okay, so I will first introduce sir to everyone present out here.
Hello, good evening, everybody.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, Lauren Diaz is very excited to welcome you. I would just like to talk a little bit about sir. So, Amit Agarwal is a technologist, and currently he's working as a group digital product manager for Lois Corp, which is based in Charlotte, USA. And he's from India. He's born and brought up in Kolkata, and he moved to Bangalore. After that, he did work briefly as a software programmer for an American financial. But he was always very passionate. He was always very passionate about entrepreneurship, and he created something of his own. So he found an opportunity to do a startup venture on e-commerce deals and coupons. But he soon realized that he wanted to level up his skill set, and in that effect, he took a break, did his MBA from Hong Kong and London. And for the last 10 years, he's been extremely successful and has worked in major online retailers in the US. He's lived in cities like New York, Boston, Atlanta, and Charlotte. And he's also a very firm believer in the fact that technology has the power to shape humanity. And he's also extremely passionate about the environment, which we are very excited about. And we love this opportunity to interact with you, sir, and we welcome you heartily to our daughter.
Thank you. What's your name?
My name is Pragati.
Pragati. Thank you, Pragati, for your kind introduction. I'm looking forward to talking to everybody and understanding what everybody is doing and what are their goals in life and how can I share my experience and thoughts on, you know, how can you further develop your skills around it. Should we do a quick round of introductions with everybody? Whoever's on the call?
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. So, Pradi, you spoke very kindly about me. Thank you. So, why don't we start first?
Sir, I'm a BBA undergraduate. I'm studying in Technologist University. I'm in my second year right now. And yes. In the future, I'm preparing for CAT. I do want to pursue my MBA. So, looking forward to that.
That's great. Do we have other folks as well?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir. This is Tomajati here. I am currently working in a cafe as a community manager, and also started a small startup for event management. I am from Kolkata. Mm-hmm. It's really nice to attend this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
So this is Simran here, and presently I am pursuing CA, and I graduated 2 years back from Sri Shikshetan College and working as a coordinator at Adore India.
Yeah, Simran, it's a great job of you organizing this. Thank you for, you know, getting everybody together and setting this up. Who else do we have?
So, so we do have Anaya Vaidya. She is from Mumbai. We do have Manoj Ghosh, and he is from Kolkata. He is also a college student. Then we do have Mr. Shantan here. He is a part of the tech department here at Adore. Mm-hmm. Then we do have Shubham from Mumbai itself. And also we do have Praneet Shetty.
Okay, that's great. I'm seeing a multi-city presence. That shows that Adore India is moving in the right direction, and it's getting national very fast. So, hey, thanks everybody for joining. So let me just quickly give you a brief, add more information about my life, how it went out, and how I'm in Charlotte right now. So, and please feel free to ask me any questions and drop me at any time you want to. So I was born and brought up in Calcutta, and went to St. Thomas school, in St. Thomas Boys School in Kidapa. And I always had a fascination for technology, computer. I remember I got my first computer when I was 11. This is when Windows 95 was the software operating system, long, long time back.
Yeah, that was indeed a time.
Right? Yeah, so
it was seriously a good times. We used to get this interactive CD, if you remember, with the 95, and that had games. That was our playtime and the enjoyment that we had that time.
Right. Absolutely. There was no internet back then. So this is 1995.
The internet at that time was, I guess, dial-up connection with 25 kbps of the maximum speed, if you remember.
Yes. Yes, and you have to have one phone line. So it's basically you have one phone line at home. So you have to use internet or use a phone.
Or use a phone, and they used to send a huge amount of bills if you do use the internet.
That's correct. Yeah. This is 25 years 20, back. So
20, yeah, almost 20 years back.
That's right, yes. So very passionate about technology back then. You know, we used to get big bills, and my father used to get very mad about it, as Shayantan just said. Now they feel good about it because of my passion for engineering and technology. I am here where I am. So did my schooling from Calcutta, and then went to Bangalore for my engineering. I did electrical and electronics engineering, and after my engineering, I worked in Bangalore for a couple of years, and then went to the US, and then have been in the US working in e-commerce. So I worked for Amazon for a time, for a few months, and then I worked for Home Depot, which is basically the largest retail. Yeah. Has anybody heard about Home Depot? Have you heard about Home Depot?
Yeah.
You have? Okay, yeah, so Home Depot is a $120 billion retail business. So they are massive, and every store is bigger than the metro stores in Calcutta. You know, the metro in... Right? Mm-hmm. So they are, and they got 2,200 stores around the world. And so it's huge, and so work for them. Now I'm working for a competitor of theirs in the same space, slightly smaller, but very similar company. And, you know, my role is to basically find technology innovations and build software products and solutions help customers solve their problems. So to give you more details, if a customer wants to redesign their bathroom or redesign their living room. So I have built technology using AR and VR, using augmented reality.
Okay.
So they can, when customers can take a picture of their living room and bring that picture to the store and then manually add,
colors, couch, shades and everything. Colors. It's a virtual reality.
That's correct. Exactly. Cool. So
that's actually very interesting.
It is very interesting, very fascinating. It's amazing how customers expect this to be a foundational functionality that you offer them. It's not a novelty anymore. So customers expect that, hey, this is something I need to do my job. So big shift in customer thought process. So I'm sure this is coming to India soon. India is a big adapter of technology. So I'm sure it'll come soon. But
It has already come to India though, but through only gaming for the time being. So
right,
yeah, come down with other forms also.
It will. I have no doubt. I have. I think we cannot get enough skilled engineers and in the US, and with the whole H-1B challenges that your truly Donald Trump has brought. It's made it very difficult to find the right talent. So to hire one engineer, I may have to spend 3 months or 4 months. So very difficult right now. So yeah, we should be very proud of all the value that India has been bringing on the technology forefront. We have just done such great stuff. So it's a every time I would go to some place, if I find some white person in a store or anywhere, and their first question is, are you a doctor or are you an engineer? So when an Indian is seen in America, the perception is that they are going to be smart, they will be very successful, and they will be doing very well in their professional career. So we need to give this recognition to our culture that has intelligence and that has curiosity, educational curiosity as a top priority that shapes all of us into these successful professionals in America and other countries.
Right. Okay. So why did you decide to move to the US suddenly?
So it wasn't sudden so much, but after my MBA, I was trying to build a business in India. And I was building a FMCG brand, brand that. So basically, you see these Lakmes and Gillettes and all these brands, right? So they sell. I was trying to build a brand in India that would manufacture men's grooming products.
I see.
And we did all the work for it, and we gave it a shot. But it's very difficult sometimes to succeed unless you are very patient. It takes extreme persistence. Mm-hmm. So I think I can safely say that I took the easy route, came to the US instead of working hard and being persistent and staying in India and building a business. So that's my story. Yeah. So that's the reason I came here. Again, as I said, I'm a big technology buff, and I think I could use my skill set in the US more than at that time in Calcutta. I wasn't interested in moving out of Calcutta at that time. So yeah, that's my story. That's why I moved to the US.
I see.
So sir, what happened to the startup?
So we gave it a couple of years. So what I realized is that everybody this is my second startup after my MBA. So this is so I'll talk about my first startup after my engineering, but let's talk about the second one first. So the second one, this needs a lot of operational efficiency. It needs a lot of operational brilliance and operational skill set, and I felt that is not my core competence. my competence is more around, you know, understanding how I can use technology to solve problems. Mm-hmm. And I could continue doing that FMCG business and, you know, add value as well. But then I think I would have done much, much more better and achieve more in technology. So I realized very soon that this is not the right path for me. So what this right. says is that as an entrepreneur, as any kind of a professional, you need to fail. Failing is fine. There's nothing wrong in failing, but you gotta fail fast, and then move on.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So quickly find what you're trying to. Yeah. That's right. Exactly. So learn from your failures and then move on. So I would say that to everybody. Let me talk about my first startup that was focused on technology and online. And this is in 2008. This is when, you know, if anybody's aware, in 2007, 2008, India was booming before the recession hit. I don't know how many of you remember that. Not many. Shyant and probably you, right? Yes. So it was a time when there was a huge boom, and every professional in India had three or four jobs in hand. You know, I could, when I graduated from college, I had four jobs in my hand, and in 2007-8 I could easily have you know, five companies were calling me, please join me today, after 1.5 years of experience, you know. So very strong market
now.
I know, I heard. But it will get better. I have full confidence that it will get better.
In terms of IT only, we have the market still up.
Everything else.
And it's just going and going and going. No, unending. Progress.
See, what I will tell you is that every there are multiple phases in every country's growth, right? Economy. So, I think... couple of years back, we saw a big peak in Indian economy,
right.
And it's basically in a path where it's slowing down a little, but eventually it has to jump. There is no doubt. I mean,
it'll be a cycle, of course.
Exactly, and it's a cycle, and it's also the trend, right? In long term, even in midterm, let's say in 5-year horizon. I mean, there is no way we cannot grow. We have to, because all the metrics say that. Of course, there are challenges around demography. There are challenges around, you know, regional challenges and social challenges in India. That are not easy to fix. But economy and opportunity will grow. I think being in India and being in the right industry is important. And I'm happy to, you know, answer some questions around that as well. So, yeah. So, what else?
So, as somebody who is not very good with technology, but I do want to pursue a career in business, a career in management, what would be the beginning steps to make myself a little bit more technologically competent, considering the environment of today? You cannot have business without technology. So what would be the first steps you could suggest to me? Yeah. That would be great.
See, technology is too big an umbrella. So when you say you're not good at technology, it could have multiple meanings. So to give you an example, I am a very bad programmer. I can't program for you know, a nice dinner. So I'm very bad at programming. But I am good at understanding how to use software to solve problems. So basically, the point is that you don't need to be very good at, you don't need to be very good at programming or, you know, write software or, you can be good at understanding how you can use technology to solve problems. And
to make my question a bit more specific, I do want to pursue marketing as my specialization in my MBA. So I really want to know more about the technological applications in marketing.
Sure.
So would that maybe make it a bit more simple to answer?
Yes, definitely. Thank you for the details. So marketing has the most technology-based innovation happening today. there is a segment called MarTech. It's called marketing technology, which is which has the most investment going from a technology perspective right now. So to give you some ideas, what is marketing? Marketing is basically investing money in an advertising campaign. One part of marketing is investing money in an advertising campaign and expecting that it would create the right amount of sales for your business and have a strong return on investment on marketing cost.
Right.
To give you more details, if you're investing, let's say, 1 lakh rupees in a marketing campaign, you need to probably make 30 lakh rupees from that marketing campaign, from sales,
right?
So this is how it works. Historically, the problem is that we were doing marketing where we were running a TV ad, or we were running a radio ad, or we were running a newspaper ad. We have no idea how much return are they giving you. Yeah. Because you cannot quantify it, right? But with digital getting more and more important, you can track everything a customer does. So we are running campaigns. Yeah, big data management, Hadoop, and so some companies that are very good at that. If you want to do marketing and if you want to be in this field and use technology, Salesforce is the biggest player in this field.
Yep.
Salesforce. Right. So Salesforce, basically what it does is that it creates a customer profile. So let's say Lowe's has 20 million customers. So I have very clear understanding of what every customer's preference are. So I know that my customer likes, so Lowe's sells a lot of appliances, you know, like an LG appliance. So if I know that Lowe's customer likes an LG stainless steel refrigerator. So I know that. So I will only send marketing campaigns to that customer with keeping that preference in mind. So there is no point me sending that customer, you know, something like maybe an ad for a hammer. Because that customer is not interested in buying a hammer or using a hammer. So that's where technology is very important, because what Salesforce and other companies are doing is that they're collecting all these data points, signals from different segments, and then creating a customer persona. And it is very, so I think if you want to be in marketing, if you want to know technology, Salesforce, good news is that it is very technology agnostic as a marketer. It's like using Facebook, you know, it's so easy to use. So. in your world it's Instagram, right? Not Facebook. So
Facebook is
what I heard. So I am still new to Instagram. I don't use it enough. So I think it's very easy to use. It's just about making sure you know how to leverage it. But I would say that if you can find a course on Salesforce, that will give you a lot of. If I'm hiring a marketing person out of B school. If I see Salesforce, you are my candidate. So,
I see. Thank you. Thank you a lot.
So, I have a question. Currently, I'm pursuing BMS. So, my question is, if I have a startup idea and if I want to start it, so how should I go forward with it?
Do you have a specific idea in mind, or are you... Do you have an idea in mind?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. See, what you could do is that, let me tell you one reality about ideas, okay? If you think your idea is unique and no one else has done it, that is never true.
Someone's already done
any,
thought of it.
Someone probably has already tried it. Someone probably has thought about it.
I agree.
So, always vet out the fact that if you have an idea, if that has not been done in the market, why is it? You know, you know, there is a saying in our industry, it is to connect the dots, first collect the dots. So basically, you, before you start an idea, you got to do your market research. So I would reach out to all my contacts, send them a Survey Monkey, you know, like a survey. So Survey Monkey offers these free surveys where you can ask them 10 questions about what you're trying to do. Get their thoughts, collect 100 reviews, and, you know, get it from people you don't know as well, you know. So ask your friends to forward it to other people so that you get an unbiased point of view. And look at all that data and you will see that whether your idea has potential or not. See, so I think that's the first step about doing anything. First, understanding that does your idea have an opportunity or not? Does the is that solving a customer problem or not? You know, I'm sure you all have heard about this NASA story where NASA built a $5 million pen that worked in space.
Yeah.
And, the Russians built a, they just gave the pencils to the NASA, the astronauts.
Yes.
So yeah. It's funny, right? Because sometimes we try to use the biggest, best technology to solve problems that can be solved in such an easy way. And India is the country of Jugaad, right? We are the country where we know how to use minimalism to solve big problems. So first, find out that does your idea have an opportunity? That's one. Second is, once you get some understanding of that, once you get a confirmation, yes, this is the idea, this has opportunity, start small. Don't think about, see, there's a concept in technology, in software development called MVP, which means minimum viable product. What it means is that what can you offer as a simplest solution to the customer so that they get some benefit from it without investing a lot of money in it? Offer a simple solution first, see how it does, then invest incremental investment on the business. So when you do that, the benefit is that your risk is lower. So you have an idea to build a beautiful bag. Let's say you want to build a bag and you invest 2 crore rupees in a plant, let's assume, and you build a factory, you get the machines, then you finally get to know that customers don't want that bag. That's a big problem, right? So it's extremely critical to do your research before you take an action. So whenever I'm building a software product, you won't believe this. If it takes 6 months to do that project, build a product, my first 2 months is only doing discovery and research to understand if there is a need for that product. So I think start with that. And then when you find it, there's a need, then start small. Take a small step first. So if you give me what are you trying to do, I can give you some high level thoughts on, you know, how can you approach it? No? Okay. Yeah, so I think just take the approach where you understand the opportunity, then find the smallest solution with the least investment, and then depending on the results, invest more money on it, invest more time on it. What I will tell you about India, which is the biggest success story of India, is that, you know, use friends and family. Your family, your friends are there to help you in the best way they can, which is amazing. Back out in the US, I have so many, you know, friends who are Americans, who, if they want to stay with their, if they go to visit their family or visit their brother, they stay in a hotel. They don't stay with them, though that brother may have a 5-bedroom house. That's a culture. So our culture is to help each other, you know, support each other through the tough times. I remember when I was 2 years old, 1 year, I think 2 years old, we had a 2-bedroom house and 18 people lived there, 17 people lived there. So, and you know, 10 of us lived there permanently, and there were people coming in every week, you know, from different cities, because Calcutta was a big city and the people from Siliguri, Odisha, Bihar would come and stay with us, right, family. So, and there was never a problem with space, which is amazing. You know, now people have 5-bedroom houses and they don't have enough space. So So it's amazing. So I think our country's biggest strength is the culture of supporting each other. So please leverage your friends and family, even in the least way you can. So yeah. So.
I would love to talk to you regarding my idea, but obviously not on this platform.
Sure, you can get my information from Simran, and I'm happy to talk to you. No problem.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. What else? What else is exciting right now?
Sir, I do have a question. Since you have been a resident of India as well as USA, so what is that one thing, the difference between the youth that you find in India and abroad? And what are the few topics that you want to inculcate in youth staying abroad? It might be Indian staying in abroad or even the abroad, means, you know, USA citizens, the youth.
So, Simran, can you repeat your question, please? I think the voice is breaking.
Yeah, is my voice audible, sir?
It's fine. Yeah, it just broke for a couple of times. Yeah.
Okay. So, sir, I wanted to ask that since you were a resident of India and presently you are a resident of USA, so what are the topics, like what is the difference between the youth in India and abroad? And what are the few topics that you want to inculcate in, you know, youth staying abroad, the Indian youth staying abroad?
So let's start with the difference between youth in India and in the US. So US in the Western countries, you know, US or any other country.
Yeah.
See, the big difference between the youth, what I see in the youth in India is that they are super optimistic, extremely optimistic. They think the world is their oyster. You know, I see that from an Indian youth's perspective. I think the confidence level is unbelievable. You know, when I was your age, I didn't have the confidence to just go and talk to someone on the phone like this. The way the youth is so confident and so you know, optimistic. So that is fantastic about the youth in India. And I also see this hunger for prosperity, passion for achieving big, and not believing that anything is impossible. So that is the youth in India. The youth in US, the big challenge is that you know, there's a big change in the economy in America, lifestyle in America. So America used to be a country that you know, almost gave 60% free college to students in 20 years back. So 20, 30 years back, 60% students would not pay anything for college. You know, and college is really expensive in America. It's $20,000 a year minimum, and it could be $50,000 as well per year. So that's 1.2 crore rupees for college. How many people can afford that? Even in America, not many can, right? So now everybody is burdened with big student loans. All the students have student loans, and they are suffering through that. They know housing has become so expensive that they can never buy a house. So Americans were used to endless money, endless lavishness, and that is changing now. So the change in culture is that 30 years back, at 18, every young youth would leave their parents' house and would not come back. They would come back once in a year just to say hello. You know, like they have moved out permanently, even if they're in the same city. But now, 80% young kids who live in the same city are staying with their parents because they cannot afford to stay outside. It's so expensive. So so that's a big difference between India and the US. I think the American youth today is suffering from this inconvenience of student loan, expensive housing, not enough high salaries, and they are failing to cope up with it. So I think that's a big difference. So does that answer your question?
Yes, sir, that totally does.
Okay. So what was the second part of your question?
So my second part was that what are those Indian values and cultures that you think should be taught in the Western countries?
The biggest value from India that we got to teach the youth in America is that too much individuality is not good. I would say that. So, you know, what I've seen is that, you know, Western countries, America or Germany, all these countries, the youth are, you know, the culture is that everybody is very independent and very individualistic. So they believe that the concept of privacy is very big. I'm not saying privacy is wrong. I think privacy is important, very important. But privacy has its own, you know, pros and cons in the way that, you know, I don't believe that I need to knock my son's door before I can enter his room as a parent. So yeah. In America, that level of individualism is a big deal, right? So what happens is that creates that absence of a bond between parents and kids. In the way that, you know, my friends, you know, some of them are very successful and they, some of my colleagues are very successful. If they would, if their parents come to see them, they stay in hotels. They don't stay with them. So I can't relate to that, you know, and because the culture is very, mine is mine, yours is yours. That's the culture, you know, so it's a very... Yeah. I think it has pros and cons, you know, by having a mind, you know, that clarity, you also remove that vagueness of expectation, right? Because then you don't have expectation from day one. In India, kids have expectation from parents, parents have expectation from kids, you know, when kids get older. Mm-hmm. So that creates problems too, right? But in the US, it takes to the next level. So now it's changing because kids are understanding, the youth is understanding that they cannot afford to live on their own because it's so expensive. So now you will see this concept of joint families coming back. So many joint families. If you are driving an Uber in Seattle or in Boston or New York, you make $30,000 a year. Your rent will be minimum $20,000 a year. Minimum, you know. Exactly. So. 50. So you cannot afford to live on your own. You need to stay with your parents or live with family or something. So that's one thing I tell everybody that guys don't think that being in so individualistic is right. It's collectivism is what makes you more successful, gives you the support system and the ecosystem to do well in life. So I'm all about, you know, being collective and supporting each other in achieving your goal. You know, dreams. Yeah, that's a big one, I would say. Second is always that, you know, invest in education. Even now, I want to tell you a very interesting story. I had this colleague of mine who was an engineer. So he was making a reasonable amount of money. He had a kid, a 2-year-old kid. He would not spend any money on things like going out and getting dinner. Or, you know, watching a movie in the theater. He would not spend money on that. But for his daughter, a 2-year-old daughter, he was spending $400 a month on mathematics classes, advanced mathematics classes for a 2-year-old kid. So, you know, this is why we are successful. You know, Indians are the richest, you know, richest set of people in America. You know, Indians are the most successful. IBM just has a new Indian CEO. I'm sure you know about this. So why is that? Because, you know, Indians focus on the right things. I think we focus on education. We focus on a good house. We don't focus on things that don't add a lot of value. I mean, I think that's my personal point, but I don't think investing in jewelry. Okay. So continue. I think... being more collective and investing in the right things are important for that focus is missing in a lot of the youth I see here. So, that's about it.
Okay.
So, Let me talk about, is there any other question that you have in mind, or I can just, you know, tell you more about what is the future in, you know, if you want to succeed in your career, not in IT per se, but in everything in life, you know, so I don't want to focus only on IT, but what I can tell you is that, have you all heard about artificial intelligence, machine learning?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Very much.
Right. So let me tell you this, in my opinion, in 10 years, whoever doesn't know AI or machine learning will be significantly disadvantaged.
Right.
Sorry, I missed.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So you'll be significantly disadvantaged. So, but it doesn't, it's not only about technology. It's about everything in life. So, I would say that even if you are not someone who has a technical background, you know, just doing some courses on you. Have you heard about Udemy? Have you heard about
Coursera, so Udemy?
I heard that there are in India there is a big boost in online education, right? There are tons
yes,
of
there
is. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't like the Indian cricket team sponsored by an online education team company? Bijoy,
Byju's.
Yes. Yeah, okay. Yeah, so I think
that was also a startup funded by one.
And it became a unicorn now.
It's a unicorn now, unicorn of the SoftBank in India.
It's such a proudful moment for everybody, right? It's a matter of pride that how much the Indians are doing this amazing stuff. So I just want to say that. Every month, I know some of these courses are not cheap. I think watch one less movie if you have to, you know, find finances for fund it. But continue doing, you know, set a goal for yourself. You know, on YouTube, there are so much free content around education, around things. I think... everybody needs to know in long term what is artificial intelligence, what is machine learning, because whatever you do in future will
be based on data and AI.
That's right, exactly. So you won't believe it.
In all the fields, everything is being run by data, and in a few days of time, it will be only digital intelligence. It's digital who is going to take over.
That's correct. Yes, absolutely. And if you have a...
We are going to have a lot of fun with it, though.
I, in fact, had a friend recently whose father was very high position at the Geographical Society of India, I guess. And he lost his job because whatever his job was, a machine can do it now. So you don't require him anymore. And
the machine can do it more perfectly.
Exactly. Yeah.
Interesting
and
part.
For longer. And for 12,
for
24 hours.
Process without any errors, slight errors, machine errors, and it's learning. That's deep learning, right?
Yeah.
You're right.
It's spot on. So I'm really happy and excited to know that you know so much about it. It's great because let me tell you this: if I don't evolve as a professional, even me as a professional, I will lose my job in 5 years if I don't know machine learning.
Not just the job, you lose your passion. That's the important thing. You lose your passion, you lose everything, man.
True. Very true, yes. I think pragmatically speaking, you know, for me, my job is also very important because that's what keeps the bills getting paid, right? So, the realistically speaking, you know, this is an... America is an expensive country. I cannot survive here.
So when are you planning to come back to India and do the big fun part in India itself?
So I'm already working on something right now with the partner in India.
Okay.
So it's basically using AI and machine learning again, and I've found someone from IIT Bombay and BITS Pilani.
Okay.
Who have expertise in AI and cognitive learning. So
deep learning systems, is it?
It's not deep learning specifically, but it has segments of it. It's more around NLP, you know, natural language processing. So basically, So basically, every time you say something to Google, you know, hey Siri, or you say, okay Google,
and it recognizes it.
That's right. So that is done by NLP. So, so
natural language processing.
That's correct. Yeah. So that is, everything is gonna get replaced with voice very soon. So give it 3 years, 5 years. You know, so you will stop. You talk to people on live chat. Today,
you're going to talk with bots.
You will talk. Yeah, you're right. Chat bots. So we are doing that already. So luckily, I just built a product called live chat bot that reduced number of live chats by 20%.
So okay, interesting. Based on automated replies, is it?
Automated replies and based on
customer responses on the previous data entries and the customer field of what do you call it, pattern of speaking and other things, right?
That's correct. Yes. So most questions were around what's the status of my order. So I can answer that very easily with data science, with chatbots. So I can look at your order number and easily tell you that this is the date for your delivery. So labor is very expensive in America, right? So
data is a new mine. It's the new gold mine.
It is. It very much is. So not trying to create any kind of panic, but we need to prepare ourselves for this new reality.
Huge change that is coming.
Yes, exactly. Yes. So please, invest your time. Even if you're on a Uber, if you're driving to, if you're driving somewhere, or if you're on a public transport, download that video and watch it. There are tons of great content on YouTube. On Udemy, there's a very nice course. I can send that to Simran for everybody if you are interested. But build a point of view around machine learning. In long term, I remember someone spoke about marketing, right? That marketing, how can I build a career in marketing? Salesforce has 800 data scientists.
Yep.
So, every data scientist gets paid $300,000. He's top of the value chain right now. They're the highest paid professionals outside doctors today. Top paid folks, right? So the thing is that all these guys, what they're doing is that today you are manually deciding which marketing campaign to run for which customer.
Mm-hmm. Analytics or data.
So all of that getting replaced by data science. Mm-hmm. So you just feed the data, it tells you which campaign to run for who. So, if you want to do marketing, you will probably need to start learning how it works. Not very. You don't need to know the neural network behind it. You just need to know how it works from a top level. And the course I'm going to send you from Udemy answers that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So I think this is what it is from a data science perspective. Is there any questions outside this? I can talk about more about what are my learnings in the last few years, and
share it with us. We'll be glad to know.
Great. Yeah. So let me tell you. I don't know how many folks know this, but won't believe how much respect Indian professionals have. I mean, I spoke about it that, we are seen as smart, intelligent people, but it's so common for if I have an American business partner and in but I hope you can hear me. Okay, fine. Yeah, so basically, I think we should be very proud of the brand we have created for ourselves as a country. Mm-hmm. So, and we need to thank our, our ancestors, even the people before me who came to the US and validated our culture. And I think, I don't think I would tell this to this group, but I think we should be very proud of, you know, what we have achieved and what the brand we have built of ourselves, and, you know, continue leveraging that. What I also believe is a important aspect of success is to talk to more people. Every week, you know, find, do you have meetups here? Do you have meetups here in the US? So basically what you could do is that you can find people from different segments of society. So, say Simran is a CA and someone is in, you know, Pragati is in marketing, right? So how about we find a way to talk to people who write poetry, who write literature, talk to people who are mathematics honors, talk to people who are medical students. I think it's extremely critical to talk to people from different sections of the society and different paths so that you expand your horizon. So I think what I've seen is that if you're forming a team, if you're an entrepreneur, if you're building a team, never build a team with same type of people, because then the
absolutely ideas, agree.
Yeah, you need to your ideas. Everybody should have different ideas. You know, so you will only get different ideas if you have different people. So if you ask me that, you know, if who is the best cricketer in the world, I will always say Sachin Tendulkar, right, or Virat Kohli. So, but if you get 10 Indians asking the same question, we always say the same thing, right? So there is no diversity in opinion, so, or approach. So it's important you get people from different sections of society. That's why when I said that you want to do your research, that Survey Monkey research that you wanted to do for your business, please, you know, send it to people outside your group so that you get different opinions. It's important that you get someone from a 60-year-old group and you get someone from a 15-year-old group. Let everybody answer. It's very important. So I think that diversity is extremely important. And I think the biggest reason for America's success in the last 50 years or the 60 years is the diversity it brought in. You know, there is... basically, think about America, the country, right? So you have... 300 years back, 350 years back, America only had Native Americans. Then we got some Spanish people who came in with Christopher Columbus. And then finally we got British who brought in English folks. And after that, there was not much migration besides from UK. But in 1900s, during World War I, and in late 1800s, we started seeing people from Poland, people from Russia, people from Japan, China, they all started moving to America. So the success of US is all because of all that different cultures that form the country. So now, you know, only 7% of American population have a British origin. The founders of the country, right? George Washington, who was the first president. British are only 7%. There are more Germans in America than British now. It's pretty amazing, right?
That interesting facts, how, by the way.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing how America is. Yeah. So I think it's very important. We Indians have a concern here. We have a challenge. We try to group based on common interests. So when I say common interest, what I mean is that the interest here is, you know, same caste or same language or same, you know, background. I think that's a big opportunity miss. You know, I remember, and I learned this very late in my life. When I was a kid, all my friends are Marwari. I'm Marwari, right? So it's the stupidest thing I could do, because, you know, if I'm with Marwaris, then what am I learning? We all know the same thing. We talk the same thing. So it's so critical to have different people from different society's sects
genres.
To come in. Yeah, it's extremely critical. So if you ever become a manager and you're building a team, keep that in mind. If you are starting your startup, when you're hiring people for your startup, keep that in mind. That variation in personality will play a big role in bringing new ideas. So that's a big learning for me.
Interesting of you.
So Amy, we got 4 minutes and I'm going to head out to my office after that. So is there any last
question.
Thoughts you have? And Simran, you have my information, right? And
I'll
give you my link. I'll give you my email.
Share us your projects about the NLP that you're doing.
Take care. Sure. Yeah. And so I'll tell you what I'm, I'll tell you high level since we have 3 minutes. So what I'm doing is that, in e-commerce, when you are buying a product on Flipkart or Amazon, what is the first thing you look? What does everybody look? If you're buying a new product, if you're buying a new product that you don't know.
Design of product, maybe the specs.
Does anybody look at reviews?
Yeah.
Customer reviews?
Yeah.
Yes.
So if you're buying a branded product, then you don't have to look at reviews, right? Because the brand is a review. But if you're buying an unbranded product, if you're buying a pair of shoes online, you don't know that how comfortable it is. So reviews play a very pivotal role in helping you buy or not buy the product. So my NLP algorithm is basically finding a way to understand that if I'm selling a refrigerator, then if one customer says that this refrigerator hardly cools, and the second customer says that this refrigerator cools very hard, how can I use machine learning and NLP to differentiate the two and give a summary to the customer? Yeah. So, and then start displaying it to customers, and then also sending this
based
information
on what?
To the,
the information will be displayed on what platform? On your
On the product page.
Product page with the JBox platform. Right? You'll be using JBoxes.
JBox or Java box?
Yeah, Java boxes. You'll be using Java boxes to display the product data.
It could be anything. So the platform is agnostic, right? Machine learning is agnostic to the platform. So it could be Java, it could be ASP, it could be anything.
PHP.
But yeah, the goal is that machine learning using Python will basically build the model, and then you can display the data on any platform. You know, it doesn't need to be Java, could be anything.
Okay.
But the key point here is that I have 5,000 reviews,
hardware specs, back frame of the backbone of the system, may I ask as a technical person?
So
I'll be much more interested in that.
Sure. So basically, I think the world has moved away from hardware, right? I mean, I don't even consider hardware anymore because I use cloud. So we are using Google Cloud, GCP.
Yep.
Google Cloud platform. So I don't have to worry about what hardware Google is using. They are probably using their own.
But you have to worry about the performance, isn't it?
No, but GCP, the cloud cares about that, right? So cloud tells me that this is the performance I'll get. So I am indeed. So that's the future, right? So it's not the future; it's the current right now. It's the current thing.
Under the current scenario, what is the amount of requests your system or platform can handle?
I would say
per second. So
Or at this stage, I think 120,000 for now because it's too early.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
But
that's good.
But my goal is to take as much as. I mean long term, but it's expensive, right?
It's a long term.
So if you get more computing power, you need to pay more for it. So that's why it's very important to take
thing on this. In fact, we have our website and servers on GCP itself. So
And that's the whole idea about MVP, right? Don't invest too much money in your business before you know if it's successful or not. That's the biggest mistake a lot of people do. You know, I meet people, they're like, I need a big office when I start my business. I said, why would you create that sunk fixed cost for yourself? Make sure your cash flow is you know,
at make least sure start you have a balanced level and you can just move away with the gas story, right?
That's why, yeah, that's why all the companies in the world are suffering now, all the startups, right? Everybody's losing money because they think
and
we should
losing
go
money
fast.
Very quick.
Very quick, exactly. Look at Oyo. Oyo is losing $1 billion
a
year.
Almost, yep, yep. Yes, we are going to go bankrupt in a few years if it goes like this.
I don't think Oyo is ever going to close down because Oyo is really...
It's not going to close down since it has a backfunding for SoftBank. I don't think they are not going to leave them just like that. They're going to take over and maybe remodel the whole banking system and maybe remodel the whole system itself. But more or less, it was a very good, it was a jewel of SoftBank in India as I use, but it lost its status. That is actually very sad.
No, it's very sad because so the story is that before I joined Lowe's, I had an offer from Oyo as well in the US. So Oyo is moving its headquarters to California.
Okay, is it so?
Yeah, so they were, but I don't know. I think they are changing it now. But 6 months back in June, the entire leadership was moving to California. In fact, Ritesh Agarwal bought a house in Palo Alto in California.
Okay.
Ritesh bought a house in, yeah. So I think the number three guy, Sinha, Anubhav Sinha, he moved to California too. Because they had built, I mean, India, right? India is, they have already captured a lot of the market. America is a big market. So they wanted to focus on America because the profitability is higher here. So, so I think that's a tough thing about the Indian economy that we should celebrate businessmen. We don't do that enough. We try to create problems for them, and I think in long term,
the biggest businessmen problem is with the promo codes. I guess we are always running after promo codes and promo codes and promo codes, not with the proper service.
And then we also expect service, right? We also want service. So
very well said.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I think it's a tough market. India is a very tough market. But whoever has cracked, look at Jio, right? Look at Reliance Jio. Look at how much they have grown, right? Because
Jio had their networks, bro. They had their oceanic fibers, isn't it? They got an upper hand.
I miss that. Hey, let's do this. I'm going to send my number to Simran. Simran, please feel free to, you know, socialize it. And,
yes, sir.
Happy to talk more. Happy to give any questions you have. I hope this was helpful for everybody. Would love to get some feedback if you can give that to Simran. And I'm your resource. I'm at your service whenever you need me.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Right.
On behalf of Adore India, I would like to thank you for taking our time, despite of being this odd hour differences in timings, and sharing your experiences with us. So we are grateful here at Adore India for giving your time and effort for, you know, sharing your thoughts, experiences, your journey, and also having this interactive session with us. Thank you, sir.
You're more than welcome. I hope this was helpful.
Yes, sir. This was very much.
Thanks, Simran, for setting it up.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Best of luck, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Bye, sir.